Last week we started a study of the book of Nehemiah, really just the first chapter of Nehemiah, as we've been looking at three lessons to learn from this great text. And we noticed from verse 4 of Nehemiah chapter 1 how Nehemiah is going to offer this prayer acceptingly and also tenderly. He will offer this prayer with a heart that is moved at the thought of his people being in danger, and his tender-heartedness towards spiritual things, and how that's a lesson for us, how our hearts should be in tune to the knowledge that spiritual things are most important. And so before we ever read a moment or a word from his prayer, we learned from Nehemiah last week that when he received this tragic news, he did not go into denial, he did not reject God because of it. Instead, he turned to God because of it. And so he prayed acceptingly, and he prayed tenderly. The second lesson to learn from his prayer is that we should bring our problems to God, and we should pray to God, and we should do so reverently. And you see that in the first statement that he makes in his prayer, verse 5. Nehemiah said, I beseech thee, O Lord God of heaven, the great and terrible God, that keeps covenant and mercy for them that love him and observe his commandments. The second lesson we learn is that when we take our problems to God, yes, we do it acceptingly. We don't reject God. We do it tenderly with a tender heart. But here we learn we do it reverently. We approach God with reverence. And look at the words of description that Nehemiah offers about God as he opens this prayer. He opens with, O Lord God. That's immediately a declaration that you are bigger than me. Oh, Lord God. Oh, who is greater than me. Oh, Lord. That this word is Jehovah or YHWH, Yahweh. This is the unspeakable, unpronounceable, unknowable word that defines God. There really is no definition, I suppose, to the word. If you wanted to put one, it would be the self-existent, eternal I am. And so he says, O Lord God, Adonai, of heaven, the great and terrible God. Now, we use the word terrible often to mean a horrible thing, a bad thing. But the word really means it is a powerful thing, something of great terror. It can do great things, and that speaks of God. O great means awesome, means incredible to behold. Great and terrible. So awesome and powerful. You see the words of praise he offers to the Father in heaven. The great and terrible God. The God, he says, that keeps covenant. This is the faithful God. The God who has not let his people down. They've let him down. Because of that, they've gone into captivity and all these problems have started. They're their problems. God did not put the problems on them. They put it on themselves. But God has always said throughout history, I will be faithful to you. If you're faithful to me, I will help you through your struggles if you will give them to me to help you. God doesn't take away our free will. He is faithful to us. He doesn't control us like a master on a chessboard. He allows us to make the moves, and then he helps us pick up the pieces when we mess up. He gives us the free will to choose what path to take. But he has always shown himself to be a faithful God. And Nehemiah writes here, he's a God who keeps covenant. He keeps his promises. He keeps his own law. He says what he's going to do, and he does it. So he keeps his covenant. And he says, and mercy, keeps covenant and keeps mercy. He is a forgiving God. Has God's people sinned much against him? Absolutely. And yet over and over, every time they repent, God has forgiven them. Sometimes punishment still has to be given. A child can break something of his parents that they said, don't touch that, and they break it. They're still going to lose their toys, but they're going to be forgiven before they lose their toys. They're going to be forgiven before the punishment's even administered if they ask for forgiveness. The problem with Judah was they never asked for forgiveness. The problem with Israel was they never asked for forgiveness. In the time of the judges, certainly. And God would send in a nation to conquer the people, and they would ask for forgiveness, and God would raise up a judge to drive the oppressors out, and that cycle would just repeat. But that cycle proves the faithfulness of God and the forgiving nature of God. If I sin 1,000 times and I repent 1,001 times, God will forgive me 1,001 times. It doesn't matter how many times I sin. If I ask for forgiveness, I will receive forgiveness. And so he praises God. And he says he is a God of mercy for them. But then he adds the caveat that we've already mentioned. He keeps his promises and he's faithful. and forgiving to them that love him and observe his commandments. Jesus says, John 14:15, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. You want Jesus to be faithful to you? Love Jesus and keep his commandments. Second lesson we learned from Nehemiah is that if I am faithful to God, he'll be faithful to me. If I ask for forgiveness, he will offer forgiveness. And I can approach the great, awesome, and terrible, powerful God. But I can do so as a Christian, Hebrews 4, boldly, because I have Jesus Christ as my mediator to go through him to God. And so as Nehemiah offers this prayer, he opens with words of praise to God for his great power. But you notice also, verse 7, to skip over verse 6, which we'll cover next week. Verse 7, he says, we have dealt very corruptly against thee. We have done wicked against you. We have degraded ourselves, dealt corruptly in your sight. We have not kept your commandments, nor your statutes, nor your judgments, which you have commanded thy servant Moses, and which Moses handed down to the people. Though he recognizes that, he still offers the prayer, because God is a forgiving God. And so the second lesson we learn from this first chapter of Nehemiah is, no matter what I have done, I can approach the great and terrible God. I can expect to find forgiveness, mercy, the way Nehemiah puts it, and I can expect to have a God who is faithful to me and who will help me through my problems, as God has proven over and over that he will do. We'll notice the rest of the chapter, verses 6 and then verses 8 through 11, next week as we finish the third lesson to learn from Nehemiah chapter 1. Until then, thank you very much.